On the occasion of the centenary of World War I, the Goethe Institute Australia invited notable international historians and the public into its residence in Sydney. The 2014 War Symposium was designed to give experts and audiences an opportunity to discuss the relevance of past world wars for today's societies in Australia and Europe. Supported by the Foreign Office of the Federal Republic of Germany, the event was organized by the Goethe Institute Australia in conjunction with the Department of Hebrew, Biblical and Jewish Studies at the University of Sydney and the Sydney Jewish Museum. A small exhibition illustrating the life of notable early Austrian peace activist and Nobel laureate Bertha von Suttner fittingly surrounded the participants.
Verehrte Gäste, liebe Freunde des Goethe-Instituts, ich begrüße Sie alle auf das Herzlichste zu unserem Symposium. Vielleicht aber ist Humanität nichts anderes, als dass sie das Bewusstsein des Schreckens wachhält, dessen, was nicht mehr sich gut machen lässt. Theodor Wiesengrund Adorno, Quasi una Fantasia, musikalische Schriften 2. Good morning, distinguished guests, dear friends, and partners of the Goethe Institute Australia, old and new. It's really lovely to see you on this Friday morning. Thanks for taking the time. On behalf of the Goethe Institute in Australia, I would like to extend a very, very warm welcome to all of you. And I would like to thank all our guest speakers, partners, and friends for the immense contribution they have made to make this public event possible.
The Federal Republic of Germany is keen to stand by its obligations to commemorate and support research into the past, though not for the sake of this centenary alone.
Natürlich ist in diesem Jahr 2014 und dem 100. Jahrestag des Ersten Weltkriegs das ein wichtiges Thema, auch in unseren bilateralen Beziehungen logischerweise. Aber ich denke schon, dass die Befassung mit diesem Thema in diesem Jahr auch durch das Goethe-Institut, auch durch andere Veranstaltungen, die die Botschaft in Canberra oder wir hier als Generalkonsulat in Sydney machen, schon eine sehr wichtige Sache ist. Denn wir, glaube ich, haben unterschiedliche Perzeptionen zum Teil über das, was den Ersten Weltkrieg ausmacht.
Diese Unterschiede gibt es ganz sicher. Paul Fussell, ein Autor, den ich sehr schätze, hat über die englische Haltung zum Krieg gesagt, die wird charakterisiert von einem gewissen Phlegma. Eine Aufgeregtheit, die es in Deutschland, auch in Frankreich gegeben hat, ist in England eigentlich weitgehend, nicht ganz, aber weitgehend abwesend. Und ein wenig was von dieser Distanz zu den Ereignissen des Ersten Weltkriegs ist bis heute spürbar.
Peter Monteith is publishing a book and curating an exhibition on World War I internment. His research shows how many people who had little to do with Germany were incarcerated in Australia and subsequently deported, though they had done nothing wrong.
No, they weren't criminals. They were perfectly innocent. Lots of them were people who were just in the wrong place at the wrong time. So they were, in some cases, Germans who just happened to be in Australia when the war broke out. In other cases, they were people who'd been living in Australia for a long time, were perfectly loyal Australians, but there were these suspicions, so they became victims of circumstances and not themselves culpable in any way. And you know, you can say certainly undeserving of being treated in that way.
The book The Enemy at Home by Nadine Helmy and Gerhard Fischer reveals details that many Australians had not been aware of to date.
Die erste Reaktion ist im Allgemeinen großes Erstaunen. Was? Internierung im Ersten Weltkrieg? Alle wissen, dass es Internierung im Zweiten Weltkrieg gegeben hat, aber dass es diese Camps im Ersten Weltkrieg gegeben hat, und dass diese Camps, es gab ja drei Camps, auch relativ viele Menschen untergebracht hatten, das ist total unbekannt.
There was a genuine fear there that was whipped up, I think, partly for political reasons. You know, in Australia a bit later then there were conscription campaigns, and to encourage people to enlist or to vote in favour of conscription, it was necessary to create this image of the enemy at home. So it, unfortunately for those Germans, it fitted into that broader context of what was happening in Australia politically and socially. Now, especially 100 years after the First World War, it's so long ago. I think the attitudes have changed, and I think there's probably even some space for some broader public recognition of that in the way that's happened with Turkey. So I think for some time now there's been this sense that there's a kind of brotherhood between Turks and Australians as a result of that common experience of fighting in the war, even if it was against each other. I think we're at a point where that kind of attitude could be embraced by Australians and Germans as well.
Reconciling requires overcoming ancient perceptions of friend and foe and other negative stereotypes. So propaganda, as the inevitable prerequisite of all armed conflict, was the topic of much lively discussion between the panel and the audience. German military historians are unequivocal about the fact that the German Army Command worked very hard at engineering propaganda, which resulted in some of the most atrocious war crimes committed by German forces in World War II.
Die Generale und oben wussten es ganz genau. Und als der Krieg schlecht lief, ab September, Oktober 41 in Russland, da wurde wieder sehr viel mehr Ideologie hineingepackt. Also der Jude ist der erste Partisan. Oder der Kommunist, das sind die besonderen Leute, die wir greifen müssen, um sie dann eben zu liquidieren. Und deshalb kommt es eben auch zu diesem großen Massaker, wie wir sagen, oder Mord an den Juden von Kiew, fast 34.000, wo die Wehrmacht einen Kordon stellt. Sie selber spricht von weniger Leuten, aber sie hilft. Und ich meine, das ist etwas, ein klarer Mord, den die SS begeht, aber auch mit Wehrmachthilfe.
Most Jewish immigrants arrived down under after World War II. Today, Jews make up less than 0.5% of the Australian population.
Hier in Australien hat man über Jahrzehnte, wenn man will, eine traditionelle Anglo-Saxon jüdische Gemeinde gehabt, die sich nach England orientiert hat. Und dann hat im frühen 20. Jahrhundert gab es eine erste kleine Einwanderung aus Polen und dann natürlich der Einfluss der Vorkriegs Flüchtlinge, 9.000, Deutschland, Österreich und dann vor allen Dingen die Holocaust-Survivor nach 1945 haben natürlich grundlegend die Demografie des australischen Judentums verändert.
Despite their small representation, Jews still face discrimination and antisemitism appears to be on the rise even in Australia.
I would love not to have to research and write about antisemitism. But it seems to, in terms of my research, to follow me. It's a topic I can't get away from. And so I think that it is a problem that young people, and I'm talking about my university students, don't know enough about the dangers of prejudice. And I think that not being aware of the dangers of that type of narrative is problematic.